Now, because we are having a talk about hyperandrogenism after this, so I'll focus myself only to core gynecological aspects of adolescent girls, and because they are also, very cryptic in their presentation, they present to the pediatrician, and unless they are objective questions asked for, sometimes the child would come in, sit with the mother, and go back even without, discussing what's going on with the child. So, what I'll limit my talk to the menstrual disorders, the adolescent sexuality, contraception, and the reproductive health of the adolescent girl, hyperandrogenism, and core gynecological pathology. That those are things that are, will be very exhaustive. So I'll, just try to touch base on certain issues regarding it. So my first case is the cases that I'll be choosing are three: the case of abnormal uterine bleeding in young girls, ovarian cysts, and adolescent endometriosis. Now, before going, what is abnormal uterine bleeding? Amenorrhea, we all know, primary, if there are no periods by the age of 13 or more than 3 years, the girl has already had her thalarche and not yet started her period. Secondary amenorrhea, if there are no periods for 3 months, we call it secondary. Now, what is oligomenorrhea? Because there's, a lot of your gynecologists use these terms, and many pediatricians, they get very confused about this terminology. That's why I've sort of brought it. So oligomenorrhea is infrequent period, but the frequency is as per the years of menarche. In the first menarche year, if somebody is having less than six periods, she is oligomenorrhea. And in the from second to fifth year, if there are less than 8 periods, it is oligomenorrhea. So having a period duration 6 weekly would be oligomenorrheic. Only after fifth year of menarche, we would use the adult definition of oligomenorrhea, which is a cycle of more than 35 days. Coming on to menorrhagia is heavy menstrual bleeding. If the duration of bleeding is more than 7 days, if the frequency is less than 21 days, it is menorrhagia. So this is a 16-year-old girl who presents with short stature and anemia to a pediatrician and endocrinologist. She has already had 2 units of blood transfusion. And her onset of menarche is 15 years. Clinically, there's only short stature and anemia. And if objective questions regarding her periods are not asked, mild cases of anemia and moderate cases of menorrhagia will be missed. But this girl actually had regular cycles with heavy periods, and she did not think that it was a cause of anemia. So it's very important to actively ask a question whether her periods, what are the kind of periods that she has, basically what are the pointers to menorrhagia. It's very important, because if you don't ask the history, you will never get to know that the period is actually heavy. If she is bleeding for more than 7 days, if there are any clots, if the bleeding is so much that she wakes up at night, it's very difficult to objectively identify heavy bleeding. So subjective questions are also very, very important. If the girl is missing school due to heaviness of the bleeding, she thinks that she'll have accidents at school and she's missing school, that means that she has a pretty much heavy period. She's missing school functions, she's missing tuition due to periods. So every month, she's losing a lot of, academic and social inhabiting things. If there are bleeding accidents, and if there is associated anemia, we should always think that this is menorrhagia, because sometimes the girls will not be telling this upfront. So if there is menorrhagia, and you have checked it through the pointers, majority of cases of menorrhagia in young girls are physiological. This is completely in contrast to what we are used to see as gynecologists. We see more of pathology in menorrhagia, but almost 80% cases of adolescent or pubertal menorrhagia are physiological, and they happen due to immature hypothalamic pituitary excess leading to anovulatory bleeding. These cycles may be regular, these cycles may be irregular, but heaviness is because the endometrium is not tuned enough into a proper pattern, causing excessive bleeding. Usually, this type of heavy menstrual bleeding resolves in a year or two. Once the anovulatory cycle change from two ovulatory cycles. Usually these are mild cases, but sometimes they can be severe. Treatment is needed if the menorrhagia is actually affecting the social life and causing anemia. Treatment is needed, but pathology, even when the pathology is not present. Coming on to pathological causes, pathological causes could be a bleeding disorder, which is very less common in adult patients with menorrhagia, very rarely, but in younger age group, the diseases like von Willebrand disease, idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, or platelet function defects could lead to first presentation only when the girl become menarche, because these are mild causes of bleeding diathesis. They have a history of excessive bleeding after injury, or a family history of mother having abnormal uterine bleeding and undergoing hysterectomy at a young age, or PPH during her delivery, and unexplained ecchymosis. So those pointers should point you towards a bleeding disorder leading to pathological excessive menorrhagia in a younger girl. Now, systemic causes also can lead to an immature hypothalamic pituitary axis, a disordered HPA axis temporarily. Disorders like chronic renal failure, chronic liver disease, celiac disease can all, cause an ovulatory cycle and heavy bleeding. And these are the causes that are also very important in adolescent girls, which are not present in adult girls. And I'm repeating this again and again, because menorrhagia is quite very commonly managed. Abnormal uterine bleeding is very commonly managed by adult gynecologists. But it's a completely different etiological profile in adolescent girls. And those points should be kept in mind. And a systemic disorder should always be ruled out when we are looking at a girl with menorrhagia. And usually these are sick children with features of, growth failure. And if those are the pointers, and the systemic disease features may also be present. So you should be, keep an open mind that this may not be a purely gynecological case. A girl is presenting menorrhagia as a secondary effect of the primary systemic disease. Of course, there can be gynecological cause. And I said less than, 5 to 10% of girls presenting with menorrhagia in adolescent age group have core gynecological problems like, endometriosis or a fibroid malignancy and genital tuberculosis. The key feature to identify whether this is a gynecological cause of menorrhagia or other causes would be pain. If the girl is having irregular cycle with pain, then that should be a pointer towards a gynecological cause of menorrhagia. And usually most gynecological causes would be picked up on imaging. Endocrine causes of menorrhagia are also there, and usually they have features of the endocrine disease. Usually they have obesity associated and features of hyperandrogenism. Especially in PCOS, many girls present with menorrhagia as a clinical presentation. So coming back to our girl who had severe menorrhagia and severe anemia, now this girl was worked up and she did have a little bit of growth failure with a short stature and, asthenia. She has a really, body weight was very less. She was hypertensive and moderate anemia, and she was a case of chronic kidney disease. So basically, her ultrasound workup was normal. So it's very important to identify systemic diseases in pubertal girls with menorrhagia, rule them out before, identifying any, just because an ultrasound is normal doesn't mean that this girl does not have a pathology. Key things to look for a girl with menorrhagia in adolescent age group would be to confirm menorrhagia. And to confirm menorrhagia, we generally use the PBAC chart, and I will explain them later. But more importantly, subjective methods of confirming menorrhagia are the pointers. As I said, if the girl is missing school due to heavy bleeding, she's having accidents, she's missing, social functions just because she thinks that she will not be able to manage her periods, she has clots, and she has associated anemia, those things should be electively, actively asked in history, because sometimes the girl presenting with anemia will not be telling you that she has heavy periods. The other thing would be to rule out secondary causes, very important, chronic diseases, endocrine diseases, and for a core gynecological cause to cause menorrhagia, pain is a very important history that you should take. If menorrhagia is associated with pain, menorrhagia is not responsive, not improving, then probably it is a gynecological cause of menorrhagia. Coming on to this 14-year-old girl with known case of celiac disease, she was being followed in the endocrine clinic very diligently. Right from the age of 8 years, she had celiac disease and she was very compliant with the diet. Normal growth, normal onset of puberty, normal progression of puberty. And her last follow-up, all her tests were normal, including her thyroid workup, her hemoglobin was fine, and her TGT was negative. Suddenly, in her next follow-up, she developed anemia. And because of our interactive, this is from our own endocrine clinic, because of these interactive classes that we have, one of our residents, basically took an active history and found out that she had onset of menarche and her periods were really heavy. So basically, even in a core case of endocrinology, a girl can develop menorrhagia due to immaturity of hypothalamic pituitary axis, which is inherent in the pubertal, which is a physiological change that happens in the puberty. And such girls can have, anemia due to menorrhagia. So a detailed history of menorrhagia was taken and this girl had all the pointers present and it was very easy, but we did a PBAC chart, and if a PBAC score, basically it's basically available on the net, you can see that you give it to the girl to score her pad numbers, her sanitary towels, according to the days of bleeding, and then give a score. If the score is more than 80, it is basically menorrhagia. Usually, as I said, 80% cases of pubertal menorrhagia, the pathology is not in the uterus. It is basically immature pituitary axis leading to anovulatory bleeding, which resolves later on. So this girl was a physiological case in an endocrine cause, which led to menorrhagia. How to manage menorrhagia? Basically, if the cycles are regular and the bleeding is mild, giving tranexamic acid in 50% of cases, the amount of bleeding will be less, and the prevention of basically anemia would happen, and eventually they grow out of the disease. As the hypothalamic pituitary axis matures, their menorrhagia will become better. But if the cycles are very frequent, we have to give progesterone, and progesterone is usually given at the dose of 5 to 10 milligram norethisterone for 20 days every month to correct the anovulatory effect of the endometrium and prevent the irregular shedding. But if somebody has irregular period, infrequent period and menorrhagia, progesterone should not be the choice. The choice should be estrogen and progesterone pills, because giving progesterone in that case can lead to hypoestrogenism and poor bone accrual. This is very important in adolescent age group, because in adolescent age group, all the bone accrual is happening, and we don't want to basically suppress that physiological phenomena during the treatment of menorrhagia. Other features like dipotmetroxyprogesterone, DNRH analogs, and even Mirena has been tried in severe cases of menorrhagia, because in these cases, we want to save the uterus, and we go at many lengths to try and protect the reproductive potential of the girl. Usually in cases of chronic kidney disease, which kids who are on dialysis, we have to resort to treatments like this. And Mirena, we sometimes use for kids who have mental disability, where they are unable to manage their periods. We use them to basically avoid doing a hysterectomy in those girls and giving them morbidity of the hysterectomy. Coming on to basically the doses of acute management. So sometimes even physiological menorrhagia girls can present with acute, very heavy bleeding leading to disturbed vitals. They require admission and immediate stop of bleeding and stabilization by giving a transfusion. The drug of choice is usually norethindrone in the doses of 15 to 30 milligram in the first 48 hours and gradually tapering them. All these doses are available in our chapter in gynecological disorders of children and adolescents in the IAP test book. Basically, emergency management of menorrhagia has to be followed by long-term management later on to avoid the effects of chronic anovulation. Why does this happen? Chronic anovulation can lead to endometrial hyperplasia and a presentation of acute, really very heavy bleeding due to disordered shedding of endometrium. Basically, when to refer menorrhagia patients to a gynecologist? If there is a pelvic pain and pelvic mass, which is very easily basically identified on abdominal imaging, those are the gynecological causes of menorrhagia and had to be treated by the gynecologist, especially pediatric gynecologist. And especially if there is an, they are not responsive to treatment, we need further treatment, then you require to involve a gynecologist for all the other things. And especially if the teenager is sexually active, because there could be a component of pelvic inflammatory disease happening, leading to menorrhagia. Coming on to the second case of ovarian cysts in young girl. Now this is a 5.5-year-old girl with one episode of vaginal bleeding, with some breast development and pubic hairs. Her height is 103 centimeters and weight appropriate for age, with a ovarian cyst on an ultrasound diagnosis. Now, with such a young girl and ovarian cyst, vaginal bleeding generally concerns gynecologists, because we are more tuned to look at malignant disorders in young girls. Those are the referrals that we get. But here I would like to say that majority of simple ovarian cysts, even in young girls, are functional ovarian cysts. Malignancy is also rare even in childhood. It's not that any cyst should be worked up only for malignancy. What are the pointers of malignancy? We will get to know. So basically, ovarian cysts, if you look at the etiology of ovarian cysts, almost half of these ovarian cysts are physiological and others are over gynecological. Most of them are non-functional. They happen due to anovulation, when the follicle has not basically ruptured. It leads to formation of an ovarian cyst, but it is not producing any hormones, so we call it non-functional. The gynecological cyst could be benign or malignant cyst. Non-functional cyst, if there is some bleeding in the cyst, is called corpus luteal cyst, and all those things are actually visible on ultrasound. They are completely asymptomatic. They are just, they present with one episode of bleeding or an irregular period, and usually they resolve in a couple of months. Usually their size is less than 5 centimeters. For a functional ovarian cyst is one that is producing, it's a follicular cyst, but it is still functional and producing estrogen. It causes disturbance in the menstrual cycle. It makes it irregular. For a menarchal girl and a prepubertal girl, it may present with, temporary precocious puberty or maybe just isolated vaginal bleeding. Functional cysts can also be present along with Mackinac-Albright syndrome, which is an activating mutation that causes the ovaries to produce form cysts, recurrent cysts. And in hypothyroidism, as discussed with Dr. Anurag, because of the TSH, very high TSH can act on the FSH receptor, leading to formation of functional ovarian cysts that produce estrogen and that cause peripheral precocity, may produce with temporary or recurrent vaginal bleeding. Coming on to gynecological causes, core gynecological causes of ovarian cysts are chocolate cysts or, benign tumors, like the most common benign tumors would be a dermoid cyst or a cystic teratoma. But definitely malignant tumors are also there that should be identified. Advice about granulosa cell tumors, they are very, very rare. These are the functional ovarian malignant tumors that produce estrogen, and they present with peripheral precocity, and sometimes they produce both estrogen and androgens, leading to development of hyperandrogenism. So there was this question about functional ovarian cysts that are not resolving on their own. They could be granulosa cell tumors. Basically, the key things to look at ovarian cysts in a young girl would be the puberty status. So if she has peripheral precocity, if there is evidence of estrogenization in the form of pale vaginal mucosa, this is a functional ovarian cyst. If the growth is delayed And, you know, if bone age is delayed, it is a diagnosis of basically hypothyroidism. But a functional ovarian cyst, along with a functional ovarian cyst, if precocious puberty, the bone age is advanced, it is a diagnosis of Mackie Albright syndrome. The gynecological pointers to ovarian cyst are mostly radiological, but pointers, like if there is a very large size cyst, it could be hypothyroidism. If there are calculus spots, it could be Mackie Albright syndrome. Coming back to our girl, she was basically on examination. Her LH and FSH was low. Her bone age was not advanced. Neither it was delayed. Her thyroid workup was normal. And therefore, we come to a diagnosis of functional follicular cyst. This one doesn't need any treatment, just observation. And in a couple of months, the cyst resolves. So it's very important to look at the characteristics of the cyst on ultrasound, because that would be basically a pointer for whether this cyst is benign or malignant. And we come to it in this case. Now, this is a 7-year-old girl with one episode of vaginal bleeding. And this case we've seen in the previous talk as well. Now, this girl has very advanced breast development, but no pubic hairs. There is evidence of estrogenization with vaginal mucosa and a large ovarian cyst. The diagnosis, the key to diagnosis is looking at her growth and the bone age. She was short-statured. Usually, girls with precocious puberty are, you know, they have advanced bone age and they are generally tall. Only one diagnosis with precocious puberty, ovarian cyst, and delayed bone age is hypothyroidism. The von Guyck-Krumbach syndrome. So basically, he was confirmed and the cyst got resolved just by thyroid replacement therapy. We have got a series of 10 girls with large ovarian cyst and hypothyroidism where we were able to, correct this complete resolution of cyst in 100% of cases and laparotomies were avoided. So always do thyroid screening for your large ovarian cyst to pick up hypothyroidism. So what are the features that, where you can differentiate whether this is a cyst with a gynecological cause or a benign functional follicular cyst, if it is associated with pain. So any cyst, even if it radiologically looks completely normal, but if it is associated with pain, you need a gynecological referral. It could be even a chocolate cyst, because transabdominal scans, it is very difficult to identify the characteristics of a chocolate cyst and it can be missed. If the size is more than 5 centimeters, there is a chance it could be a benign ovarian tumor which will not respond, and that's why it needs surgical correction. If there are bilateral cysts, and if the cysts have thick walls, solid areas, septas, those are the characteristics of malignancy and should be dealt with surgically and should not be left alone. And if basically there is associated ascites. So any cyst, otherwise, majority of cases of ovarian cysts in young girls are benign and they should be treated gently. But if they have these features, they need surgical correction. Coming on to our last case. Now, this is a 15-year-old girl presented with severe progressive dysmenorrhea. Now, presentation of dysmenorrhea is also, it depends on how the history is taken. Sometimes girls present with dysmenorrhea, they are already preconditioned that pain is something that women and young girls should learn to live with. And that's why if they usually present very late, they present when it is unbearable for them. And so if any girl is complaining dysmenorrhea in your clinic, it should not be taken lightly. Now, this girl had severe pain and her pain had been worsening, but every time her ultrasound was coming normal. She was treated with NSAIDs and she was not responding. Her NSAIDs progressed to parenteral analgesia and, she had really bad, poor school performance because she was missing school. But every time, all investigations showed that she had everything normal inside the uterus. And usually in the past, when we did not have good imaging technology, such girls were, identified with having, hysteria. People used to think that they are making it up. They don't want to study. They don't want to go to school. That's why they are making it up. And that's why these cases were usually missed. Now with advanced technology, more of the severe cases, we can find some pathology in the uterus. But in early onset cases, usually the presentation is like this. And this girl actually presented very late to me. So how to deal with dysmenorrhea? Dysmenorrhea is defined as painful menstruation, which is compromising quality of life. Dysmenorrhea is very difficult to objectively guess. So if the patient is saying that she has pain, we need to identify, we take it very seriously, and we need to identify the causes. Usually dysmenorrhea in majority of girls is primary without any cause, but even that dysmenorrhea could later on turn out to be a secondary cause because of the onset of disease and the onset of pathology, there is a big delay. So basically, if the dysmenorrhea is mild and if it is improving with NSAIDs and it is improving with time, then we can safely say that this is primary dysmenorrhea. Secondary dysmenorrhea is due to pathology. And what kind of pathology can occur? About 50% of adolescent girls with moderate to severe dysmenorrhea have endometriosis. 75% if there is acyclic pain associated. Usually they have progressive pain. Usually they have irregular bleeding. The pain is acyclical. Usually it doesn't respond to NSAIDs. These girls are usually lean. So it's a chronic inflammatory disorder. It leads to a little bit of dysfunction of the intestine. Most girls have symptoms of bloating. They have less appetite and they are lean. And they have a very strong family history also. So if these pointers are present you should suspect endometriosis, as it is the most common cause of secondary dysmenorrhea in adolescent girls. But definitely with now girls becoming sexually active, we also see pelvic inflammatory disease as a cause of dysmenorrhea. They generally have vulvovaginal symptoms, and if objectively asked, they also reveal sexual activity. Fibroids are also present, but in contrast to adults, the frequency is very low, and only about 2-3% of cases of dysmenorrhea and associated menorrhagia have fibroid uterus and usually picked up on imaging. Obstructive dysmenorrhea is one of the rarest causes, but these things should also be kept in mind in adolescent age group because they present with severe dysmenorrhea, especially if they have a double uterine system, which is obstructed on one side. The key pointer to this kind of dysmenorrhea is absent ipsilateral kidney. So if a person with single kidney present to you with an pelvic mass and severe dysmenorrhea, always rule out a double uterine system with an obstructive unilateral site. So coming on to this case that of dysmenorrhea, she presented to me 10 years later with infertility, dyspareunia, and really bad chronic pelvic pain. And when I scoped her, she was a bad case of deep infiltrative endometriosis, which was completely damaged the pelvic area and led to severe infertility, which can only now be managed with IVF. If you look at these cases, because in younger age group, the disease is in its initial stages, the pain is more, but the pathology is less. And that's why always the ultrasound comes normal. The lesions are present in the peritoneum. They are not present in the ovary. Therefore, ultrasound is normal. The only way you can diagnose this is by doing a laparoscopy. And after treating, because it's a progressive disease, if you don't treat it, the lesions keep on increasing. And by the time they present to an adult gynecologist later on, the disease is so much that nothing can be done. But if this girl is treated timely, we can prevent, development of a progressive disease, a severe disease can be prevented, and that's the goal. But it also, you know, gives a better quality of life to the girl. This girl had suffered 10 big years of really bad period pain. She had bad school performance. If we could have treated, identified, you could have a really good current and long-term reproductive outcome. So adolescent endometriosis occurs in about 50% of girls with severe dysmenorrhea and 75% girls who have chronic pelvic pain. If somebody has pelvic pain, really, you know, you should get alarmed. This could be endometriosis. Now, what is endometriosis? It is the endometrial glands implanted outside the uterine cavity. So with period pains, endometrium is shed. But if these endometrium is implanted in the pelvic cavity, there is no place for that shedding happening. With every month with the shedding, it causes scarring, fibrosis, and distortion of the pelvic cavity and compromise of the reproductive potential. Usually they have progressive dysmenorrhea. They will very easily tell you that last year they would take Meftal's pass and it get better, but this year they have to take the injection. So this is a sign of progressively increasing disease, and it should directly point you towards endometriosis. Ultrasound in initial stages is completely non-diagnostic because the disease is peritoneal and the lesions are so small that they will not be picked up by ultrasound, MRI, CT scan. The only way to diagnose is doing laparoscopy. Basically, laparoscopy in adolescents is completely safe. This is a lesion of, you know, it's a red flame lesion of endometriosis on the peritoneum with, you know, those wide areas of scarring. Now, these small lesions can lead to a lot of pain because peritoneum in this area is very sensitive and the lesion is so small, but the pain is too much. Nowadays, it is becoming acceptable for the parents to, you know, choose laparoscopy. And in the last, say about 8 years of myself doing laparoscopies in adolescent girls, majority of cases we would do an operative laparoscopy when there is already a lesion, already a chocolate cyst or an ovarian cyst present. But nowadays, as many as 20% of cases that we are doing a diagnostic laparoscopy, and I think that is a healthy trend. And that's because my pediatrics colleague and other gynecological colleagues have given a lot of importance to adolescent endometriosis and started referring them earlier. So management is management of pain, prevention, preservation of fertility, and, you know, current goals. So what are the ASHRAE says about adolescent endometriosis? It says that try to manage it medically. So if you have a family that is convinced that this could be endometriosis, even, you know, when the ultrasound is normal, you could begin empirically with NSAIDs. And if she is not responding to NSAIDs, you can switch over to OCPs. But if in a girl who is not responding to these two treatments and you want to use GnRH analog, the ASHRAE recommends that, you know, you should do a laparoscopy before going ahead with those kind of treatments. And then basically medical management, there are, you know, a plethora of drugs available that can correct endometriosis. But nowadays that the drug of choice has become DynoGest, which is a selective progesterone receptor modulator, and it effectively heals the endometriotic lesions, and it has to be given long term before its effect starts coming. So this is one of the drug of the choice that has become available to us that we can use now. When should we use medical management? Usually medical management should be first line, but if you have to resort to a surgery, medical management should be used to prevent recurrence of the disease and when surgery is not possible. Endometriosis should be reviewed as a chronic disease. Once the disease, the current goals have been achieved, we have to basically keep the treatment ongoing to prevent the recurrence, prevent the distortion of the disease, prevent the progression of the disease, and to maintain the reproductive potential of the girl. Recent Visado trial is now available with the use of Visan or DynoGest in the adolescent girls, and it has found to be as good as GnRH analogs, and it is in efficacy with less side effects on the bone. Now, GnRH analogs, basically we all know, causes hypoestrogenism and lead to healing of endometriosis by causing amenorrhea. But their side effect is weakening of bone. In adolescent girls, because this is a time for bone accrual, this is a grave side effect. And therefore, using dinogest in this subgroup of patient is now one of the recommended therapies. So the key messages for adolescent gynecology that all gynecologists should keep in mind, that there are medical causes that can lead to abnormal uterine bleeding, and they should be kept in the differential. Ovarian cysts are more commonly benign than malignant, and therefore we need to wait and watch, especially if they are simple ovarian cysts. Complex ovarian cyst or painful abnormal uterine bleeding should be referred to a gynecologist, because that is a key pointer toward gynecological cause of disease. Adolescent endometriosis can occur in up to 50 to 75% of girls with severe dyspareunia, especially if this is associated with pain. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Yukita, for this wonderful presentation that covered all the aspects in that regards. We will now invite the comments from Dr. Kiran ma'am first.
Very excellent presentation, Yutika. You covered every aspect. The important thing which I would want also to emphasize upon in the ovarian cyst, that many a times we have come across, you must have also come across, that the functional cysts are taken by the general practitioners or by people, they immediately get operated. So young girls, when they do come to you that they have been removed a normal ovary, then you really feel a little sad about it. And that is what I would like everyone to understand, that many a time the cysts are functional. And you said it 5 centimeter, even up to 8 centimeter also, it is considered that they should be taken as a fair. And one should wait for these people to, if you give them time, then they do resolve. So this is a very important thing. Besides, of course, you covered everything about the functional cysts. But this point I wanted to emphasize, that they should unnecessary surgery should not be done unless and until really prove that they are not responding and they are not symptomatic otherwise. Menorrhagia, of course, you have covered nicely. And everything, the only thing is to emphasize is that you have to look for bleeding disorder and other problems also besides considering medical. But gynecologists are doing, but other people also look for, have to take care of it. In endometriosis, I wanted people to note it. Many a times in the reproductive period, when you find the endometriosis, it started almost 10, 20 years back. So it was a problem in the adolescent age, which was not taken care and now has reflected as an infertility. So, and it's a chronic stage when you must have opened the cases, you must have seen grade 3, grade 4. And then, in majority of the cases, the option becomes only ART. So, in adolescent period, though initially people used to resist laparoscopy, even now people do not agree to it in a great extent. But I think the message we all the doctors everywhere should give it to it. If there is a pain which is not resolving, if it is a significant pain in the age, that adolescent age group, they should be counseled for a diagnostic laparoscopy, and which can treat the early stages. It is not actually a diagnostic. It becomes a therapeutic also, because if the early lesions are there, you do abrade them or take care of that. And that prevents lot of complications into the reproductive age group besides these problems. So these are two important things, although you have covered each and every aspect of it. Very nice. Thank Congratulations.
You. Thank you.
Dr. Bansal, your words on this, sir?
It was just amazing, very informative and interesting. presentation was really very good. But there are a lot of questions and you have one more presentation to go on. Yeah, so,
so there are a few questions there. So Dr. Ekta is asking from UAE regarding transmix acid, how much time can we use it?
Basically, it can be used in a dose of 1 to 2 grams in 2 to 3 divided doses every month for 3 to 5 days. And you can use it, especially if you are using it in cases of physiological, non-gynecological cases of menorrhagia. It is required only for about 6 to 12 months because the girls grow out of it. So that disease is temporary. As soon as your hypothalamic pituitary axis matures, the girls grow out. In pathological causes, we have used it for girls with, you know, known cases of ITP or known cases of von Willebrand disease. We have used it very long term. It's a very safe medicine. We've used it up till 5 years, and it is to be used cyclically only when the period is happening. So it's quite a safe drug.
Dr. Varuna Vyas from AIIMS Jodhpur is asking about, since menorrhagia is frequently physiological, which patients should really be worked up in that regards?
Yes, menorrhagia frequently is physiological. As I said, the key things to look at if the menorrhagia is associated with other pointers like irregular periods, or if there is pain associated, or if there is hyperandrogenism associated, those are the cases that need to be worked up. Very importantly, severe menorrhagia, it's important to do a screening investigation and rule out systemic causes that can lead to basically problems. So it may not be doing a screening ultrasound for gynecological causes, especially in adolescent girls where we cannot do a clinical examination because these girls are not sexually active, is a must. So it is usually physiological. Mild cases, you can wait and see. But moderate to severe cases, always do the screening investigation to rule out any pathology.